Good afternoon, Namaskar. I, Kriti Vadhera, would like to welcome all our learners, viewers and students to CIT NCRT's Life On In program. This session is going to be for class 9th students, a social science session for class 9 students, and you all are watching us on PME Vidya's channel number 9. And today in this session, we will be discussing chapter People as Resource, and this is going to be the part 2 of this chapter. We've already taken the introduction chapter session earlier. Today we will be discussing more in detail about this chapter, and the expert who has joined us for today's discussion, I would like to introduce Professor Jaya Singh ji has joined. Namaskar, we welcome you.
Namaskar.
And Professor Jaya ji is from Department of Education and Social Sciences, NCERT. And before we start with today's live interaction program, I would like to add here that in between this live session, feel free to send questions. You can dial on our toll-free numbers. Our numbers would be 1-800-111-265 and the other number is 1-800-112-199. You can also send your questions on our official YouTube streaming, which is happening now on our official YouTube channel, NCERT Official. So, beginning with today's live interaction program on social science for class 9 students, Professor Jaya, I welcome you again. And as we discussed earlier, the introduction of this chapter, so I guess now we should move further in details of this chapter. And we shall begin this way only that, what do you mean by people as resource, as the title only says, people as resource?
Yeah, we've used the term people as resource because they are important factor in the economic development of the country.
Right.
I'll show you one photograph on the screen, please. You can see here the girls are going to the school. So can we call these girls as a burden for our economy? Certainly not. These girls are a resource for are very important resource for the growth of the economy. Now, how is it that the girls become an important resource for the growth of the economy? There are n number of reasons for it. Firstly, you need to educate them. And once you educate them, they become a productive population of your country. Secondly, they need to be provided with good health facility. So they contribute positively in the growth of the economy.
Okay. So, as you said, people contribute, you know, towards the economy. And here I should be considered as an asset for the economy.
The population, of course, is an asset for the economy. There are reasons for it.
Yeah.
When you produce anything in the domestic market, you need population to consume it.
Okay.
And if the country has a huge population, that automatically provides demand for those goods. So there is automatically demand for the domestic goods, and there is a large population, meaning there will be huge workforce.
Okay.
Thirdly, if there is a large population, that means saving is also large for that economy. And when the saving is large for the economy, it means they can invest in the economy. And when the saving and investment is large for the economy automatically improves. So we say population is an asset for the economy.
Okay, so now when we have understood that population is considered as an asset for the economy, for overall country, so is there any relationship between the population development and the economic growth?
Yeah, some economists say there is a positive relationship between population development and economic growth, whereas it has also been said that huge population has adverse impact upon the economic growth. So sometimes population growth precedes your economic development and vice versa. I'll give you an example. In case of USA, they educated their population and the country developed. Same thing happened in case of Europe.
Yeah.
They also trained their educated their workforce and the country developed. This trend is being followed by Singapore, Hong Kong, Japan, South Korea. They are also educating their workforce and their country is developing. So there is a direct relationship between the population and the economic development of the country.
Right. Professor Jaya, you just took so many names of the countries globally. Yeah. And if I talk about India being the second country with largest population, can you tell us about something of the consequences of a population, as a whole growth and countrywide?
See, there are adverse impact also. First, if there is a large population, that means huge mouth to be fed. And what you want to feed has to be both in the quantity as well as in the qualitative terms.
Right.
And secondly, there is also pressure on the environment. So you find the country with huge population is also a polluted country. Of course, developed countries are also polluted, but the country with huge population also has adverse impact on the environment. Then there is a pressure on the social infrastructure also. Since this is a large populated country, so you have to have a large number of schools, large number of hospitals. And then there is adverse impact, or there is a huge demand for infrastructure like road, railways, bridge, and so on.
So it means everything in terms of agriculture, in terms of infrastructure, the demand increases in terms.
Yeah, of course. So it has to be seen both positive terms as well as in the negative term. But if you want to see a positive impact, you have to educate your population. You have to provide with good health facilities and train your population.
Right.
Okay.
So, next, drawing the question from whatever you said, as we discussed about the social services led by government as well. So, what is the trend in social service expenditure by government if we talk about?
Okay, I would like to show it on the screen. In our country, education has been included under the social services. And what you can see is since 2017 to 18, and 2018 to 19, there has been growth from 6.7% to 7.6%. And with respect to education, there is increase from 2.8% to 3.1%. In the new education policy, we are talking about increasing the investment to 6%. In case of health, it has increased from 1.4% to 1.5%. So these are meager government expenditure on very important sectors of the economy, that is education and health.
Right. So these are the services led by government as we discussed. And Professor Jaya, a country like India, where we on daily basis discuss about the literacy and, Sakshat Bharat, this and that. So, but if we are talking about population as a resource in this chapter, so what is the literacy rate in India if we talk about?
Again, I'll request on the screen. Our total literacy rate is 74, and here you will find more of males are educated compared to the female. Male literacy rate is 82%, whereas female literacy rate is 65%. Now, if you want to develop your country, you need to have more education, or you need to provide more education schools and colleges for women.
Right. Professor Jaya, we have been seeing many yojanas by, government, like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Sabka Vikas, this and that. So, still we have this gap between male and female sex ratio in our country. And so many, social gaps in between male and female fraternity. So, if I ask you that, how can we minimize, do we have any steps? Because this age, 9th standard students are really molding minds. They are in puberty, which the seeds which we are going to sow here at this right age, they're going to flourish in future. So, what are the ways to minimize these male gap in between male and female? Kindly throw some light.
Sure. We have taken up this topic, I must tell you, Kriti, because we want to sensitize about the importance of population for our country. And secondly, we also want to sensitize towards the gender issue. And here, if you look at the screen, you will find the person has been indicated in purple, males have been indicated in blue, and females have been indicated in pink. So, and you can see the gap between female and the male. If you want to curb the gap between female and the male, which is evident from the line diagram, you need to provide more education facility to the female. Now, what should be done? We need to open up more schools, colleges for the girls, so that they are encouraged to be enrolled in the schools and colleges. And secondly, when there is a small family, you find women can contribute not only in the house, but she can also contribute outside the family.
Yeah.
Yeah. So these are the small provisions which we can make for the enrollment of girls in the education.
Right, right. Don't you feel, I mean, Professor Jaya, as I said, that at this particular higher secondary, secondary level, these topics really have to be discussed as they are mentioned in NCERT's textbook as
yeah.
well, as you discussed about the sensitization of this particular age group.
Yeah, yeah.
Because India as a country, mm-hmm. we have several states where the sex ratio is so low,
yeah.
and in some states it's quite good enough.
Yeah.
So, still, we are struggling with such a huge gap.
Yeah.
Do you agree with this?
I'll again request you to come on the screen.
Yeah.
Here you will have number of schools, colleges and universities at all India level. And the years are 2011 to 12, 2017 to 18. In case of primary and upper primary schools, it has increased from 11 lakhs to 14 lakhs. In case of senior secondary schools, it has increased from 0.84 to 1.24. Whereas the colleges have increased from 34,000 to 40,000, around 40,000. And universities again have increased from 642 to around 1,000.
Yeah.
So this is the increase in number of the schools, colleges and universities.
Yeah.
But
so
looking at the increase
yeah.
in the population, this is meager. We need to have more of
yeah.
primary schools, secondary schools and colleges.
So is it the gross enrollment ratio which we discussed as a whole?
Yeah. Again,
in terms
to
of
the
literacy?
Yeah, again, I like to come to the screen. Gross enrollment ratio means number of person or number of students enrolled for a particular state.
Right.
Here in NCERT, we are dealing till higher secondary state. So we'll be taking up elementary state, secondary state, and higher secondary state.
Yeah.
In case of elementary stage, you find within the year, the trend is shown between 2011-12 to 2017-18. And in case of elementary, you find enrollment of male has gone down, enrollment of female has gone down. And in case of secondary, you will find enrollment of males have gone up and enrollment of females have gone up.
Yeah.
That's very interesting.
Right.
And in case of senior secondary, you will notice enrollment of male has again gone up in the year 2017-18, and the female also has gone up from 2011-12 to 2017-18. The enrollment of female has gone up in the senior secondary stage, whereas you don't find much change in case of higher education. You can see the difference. Now, there is almost 7% enrollment in case of elementary education, but the enrollment is low when it comes to higher education. So government has come up with a new policy called RUSA, Rashtriya Uchch Shiksha Madhyam, where government wants to encourage more and more people to opt for higher education.
Right, right. So this was the gross enrollment
yeah.
ratio which we discussed.
Yeah. Yeah,
so
yeah.
if I ask you that, we took up sex ratio
mm-hmm.
and the gaps between males
mm-hmm.
and females.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at these statistics of gross enrollment countrywide,
yeah.
There must be, literacy rate which is varying from one state to another state.
Yeah.
So what is the effective literacy trend if we talk about amongst the states of India?
Yeah, I would tell you, before coming back to the state,
yeah.
I would like to say how there has been change in the literacy rate in India by sex from 1901 to 2011. Please, we'll come back to the screen, please. Yeah, the percentage, there was a change in percentage points in terms of person from 0.57 to 1.24 in 1921. So you can see the trend. It has been gradually improving in case of persons, that is when you take male and female together. But if you go by the female, you find the enrollment of female has been more than in the male. You can see the change in the percentage point. But and here, when you look at the male, you find their enrollment is less than the female. But when you look at the absolute figure, you find more of male has been more of the male have been literate compared to the female. So this trend exists from 1901 to 2011. This is so when we look at the percentage, when we look at the percentage term, we find more of female has been enrolled, but when you look at the absolute term, you find more of the male have been enrolled. There can be a discussion, good discussion on it.
Yeah.
Right.
So that was the literacy rate which we discussed just
yeah,
now.
Yeah.
And let's go on to the health segment now, of because we are talking about people as resource. So health should be the main concern.
Kriti, before we come back to the health, I'd like to take up states.
Please.
Refer to the screen. Yeah, in case of Bihar, you notice there is change. There is a percentage increase in number of literates by 74%. Bihar has largest number of largest increase in the number of literates. And in this table, you will find Orissa has the least number. And in case of Bihar, it has exceeded national average also. This is very interesting. Jharkhand comes next to Bihar, followed by Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh. And while there has been increase in percentage increase in number of literates in Bihar, there can be another very good discussion on it. There are many factors which has contributed to literacy in the states of Bihar. Right.
I guess now we can discuss about health, because health is also a major concern when we are talking about population as a resource of a country. So what is the public expenditure on health if we talk about?
I would like to discuss from the global perspective.
Right.
So let's come back to the screen. In India, we are spending only 1.2% of our GDP. GDP, you know, is a gross domestic product.
Yeah.
That is sum total of goods and services which are produced in the country. And here, in our country, we are spending only 1.2%. Whereas, if you look at the European Union, they are spending around 8.1%. And the world average is 6.5%. So, in case of India, the share of GDP, particularly in terms of health, is very low. We need to improve upon it. In fact, it is lower than the Sub-Sahara Africa. It is lower than the East Asia and Pacific, Middle East and North Africa, Latin America and Caribbean, Europe and Central Asia. So, we need to improve the public expenditure on health, particularly in case of India. India is a huge populated country, and unless and until we invest on health, our population cannot become a healthy one.
Right. So that was how we began with health sector. I mean, globally we discuss, and it is really disheartening to witness that we just spend 1.2 of our GDP on in terms of health. So when we have discussed as about the health globally as a perspective, we at times discuss about the health workers who are working in our country. So what is the role, how are the these health workers are working? Can you please throw some light on this?
First of all, I'd like to say, who are these health workers? Let's have the screen. These are allopathic doctors, Ayurvedic doctors, homeo doctors, Unani doctors, dental doctors, nurses and midwives, pharmacists, ancillary healths, traditional and faith healers. All health work together. This comes around 2069.540. Here in this table, you find we have large number of allopathic doctor, nurses and midwives. We have very few Ayurvedic doctors, homeopathy, Unani, pharmacist, ancillary health. This data has been taken from World Health Organization, which was published in 2016.
Yeah. So now when we know about the health workers, is there a division, you know, in between the rural health workers and urban health workers if we talk about?
There is a massive, very big difference between the rural health workers and urban health workers.
Okay.
And not in the term of the functions, but in the term of the presence. We have more of doctors in allopathy doctors in urban area compared to the rural areas.
Yeah.
That is why migration is very high from rural areas to urban areas. Because urban area provide you with good medical facilities.
Yeah.
Then the Ayurvedic doctors also, there is more of Ayurvedic doctors in urban area, or homeopathy doctors are almost the same. Yunani doctors exist mostly in the urban areas. Nurses and midwives again exist more in the urban areas. And then a pharmacist, ancillary health, traditional and faith healers, that's almost equal in both rural and urban areas.
Right.
That is why people migrate from the rural areas to the urban areas, because urban area provides you with many facilities.
Facilities, absolutely.
And if you have to check the migration, you have to improve the facility in the rural areas also.
Right, right. We discussed about the gaps between a male-female sex ratio,
youth
literacy rate.
Yeah,
so do we have this gap, gap of ratio in health workers as well?
Yeah, you can find more of male allopathic doctor compared to female. This is shown on the screen. More of Ayurvedic doctor, male doctors, more of homeopathy doctors, except in the case of nurses and midwives, you have more of female nurses and midwives and less of male who are nurses and midwives. Otherwise, most of the health workers are male. They have dominated this field. So in the first slide, we had shown a girl is coming to the school. We need to educate, we need to sensitize the population about the importance of health or the health facilities which are needed for productive, for the growth of productive population.
Right, right. We need to really sensitize our children for these sensitive topics which are being discussed in NCERT's textbooks.
Yeah.
So, let's go more deeper into this chapter. And I would like you to ask here that what is India's position in global, scenario if you talk about Human Development Index?
We have taken around 189 countries and India's position is around 130. The first country is Norway, followed by here in the screen is United Kingdom, which has 14th position in HDI rank. Then USA has 13th position in HDI rank. Brazil has 79. China has 86th position. And Indonesia has 116th position. Now, if you notice, if the country has high HDI index, then the country also has a high life expectancy. The country has high expected year of schooling and mean year of schooling. Let's take example of Norway. Norway is first among HDI rank as per 2017 census.
Right.
Here, the life expectancy of a person, that is a single person surviving in Norway, lives to the age of 82 years. Whereas in India, the average age of survival or life expectancy is around 70 years. So you can see the difference of 12 years. And in case of schooling also, the average year of schooling for Norway is 18 years. In case of India, it is around 12 years. And for mean year of schooling also, the average schooling or the mean year of schooling for Norway is 13 and in case of India is 6. So if we have to develop our economy, we have to focus on the population. And how do we focus on the population? We focus on the population by making them literate, by providing cheap education. Cheap education means education at provide education at less fees, not the low quality education. Then provide them with the better health facilities, provide them with continuous training, which can help in the healthy growth of the population.
Right. Professor Jayan, now when we have discussed about the economic growth, sex ratio, literacy, gross enrollment of education, and now I guess it's the time to discuss the really sensitive topic, which is unemployment, if we discuss about, you know, people as resource for a country. So what is this unemployment in terms of population we talk about?
Okay, before I go to this topic of unemployment, I like to show it through the bar graph, please, on the screen. India's position in Global Human Development Index, you can see it's around 130, that is next to Bangladesh. Whereas Norway, you can see, is first, that's available, that can be seen through the bar graph also. United States is third, HDI index is third, that can be seen on the Human Development Index, shown through the bar diagram. Then I can I would also like to show life expectancy at birth with respect to different countries: Norway, United States, Sri Lanka, Brazil, China, Indonesia, South Africa, India, Bangladesh. South Africa, in case of South Africa, life expectancy is less than India, whereas India's life expectancy is less than most of the developed countries. Then next, mean year of schooling. Again, when you look at the bar graph, you find Norway has a high mean year of schooling. In fact, USA has more mean year of schooling compared to Norway, and followed by Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka again has higher mean year of schooling compared to India. That's very interesting. Then followed by Brazil, China. While China has developed, in year 80, both India and China had the same rate of growth. But China has picked up because mean year of schooling is more than that of India. So now I'll take up your unemployment question.
We just have three and a half minutes left, Professor Jaya.
Okay.
So I would like you to address my question first and kindly add to it about the unemployment in youth of our country in terms of educational qualification.
Okay. When you look at the screen, you find those who are not literate are less employed, unemployed compared to those who have graduated. The students who have graduated, you find unemployment rate is higher than the student who is not literate. I shouldn't call them literate, or the population is not literate at all, and there are reasons for it. Before that, I like to take up this photograph. Teachers can use such images in the classroom also. This has been drawn by a girl called Parul, and when you show this photograph to the student, ask them whether will you consider this old man as unemployed. This is a very sensitive question.
Okay.
You cannot call this old man as an unemployed, because the working age population of India is 15 to 59. So you cannot call any child below 15 years as unemployed, or any person above 59 years as unemployed.
Okay.
Then there is another photograph. Here, a woman is cleaning, she is making a chapati, she is cooking, she is washing, she is looking after the garden. Now, can you, when you look at the images, you find she is working, but her work is not counted in the GDP. That's very strange. And if the same woman, if she works for other and her work is monetized, then we say
we consider in GDP.
Yeah.
That's really bad.
When she's working in a house, that's not considered, that's not counted in the GDP.
Yes.
There is another image of a boy. We can't call him unemployed because children are not considered as productive workforce.
Right.
Then there is another image of a girl who's she's 19 year old girl. She's teaching her younger brother. When you do for your own house, that's not counted in the GDP,
as employment,
so
yeah.
That's not taken as economic activity.
Right. So we have to keep these also in mind, you know.
When you work for your own house,
about unemployment, then these measures are also to be kept in mind.
When you are considering the how employment should be provided, it has to be provided outside your house, or whatever you do has to be sold in the market.
So this was from the chapter people as a resource for today. The session was really wonderful.
Thank you.
Even I learned a lot out of
it,
Professor Jaya. Thanks for joining us, PMA Vidya, today for this session.
Thank you so much.
And viewers, remain connected, because in the next session we will be taking up a maths topic, surface and volumes, for you. So remain connected. We will be coming back just in a short while. Thank you.
Thank you.